Good morning, students. Welcome to today's session. And in today's session, we will look into the three-phase circuits. We have already saw the single-phase circuits. And in single-phase, we did the analysis of RC and RLC combinations, series and parallel configuration. Then we looked into the what is the real power, reactive power and apparent power and power factor. So that part is little bit bigger, this analysis part, and this part is very easy, and also it is it won't take that much time as much as the first phase. In case of a three-phase circuit, we are going to see what is the advantage of a three-phase power. So I told you, like, all the industries, all the industrial connections, they work on the three-phase. All the domestic connections, like offices, houses, all these things, they use the single-phase. And the power generation always happens in the three-phase generation. So single-phase power generation doesn't happen. Whatever the generating stations we have, all the generating stations, they generate power in three-phase only. Once the power is generated, then power is transmitted. You must have seen the transmission line while you are traveling from one city to another city. You will be seeing the big, huge towers with the cables. So that is the transmission lines. Those transmission lines will transmit the power from generating station. Normally what happens is the generating stations, they will be in the remote locations for various reasons. For example, the resources, the raw material that is available could be in the remote places. And for example, hydropower plant. We cannot have a hydropower plant in near the load center. Load center is like a city like Belgaum, where we consume the power. The hydropower plants has to be somewhere near the dams, okay, where there is a flow of the river. Similarly, for example, the thermal power plant, maybe it will be located very close to where the raw material easily available, the coal is easily available. So that is why there is a need for the transmitting the power from the generating stations to the load centers, such as Belgaum city or Bangalore city. Once the power is transmitted, then we call it as a distribution. So once it reaches the Belgaum, we do the distribution of the power. Distribution, again, it would be three phase. And if you have closely observed the towers near your house, they are three phase only. What they do is, like, from those three phase, how they give the connection is they take one of the phase and they connect the neutral. So that is how every household will have one phase and one neutral. That's why you get two wires inside the house, and all our equipments work on the single phase. And we can easily get the single phase out of these three phases. So three phases are represented, if you might be aware, RYB, okay? That is red, yellow, blue. That is the representation of the three phases. So R, Y, and B are the three phases, and one more neutral wire. So that forms the three-phase power. So we can easily get the single power. Either I can connect R and the neutral, or Y and the neutral, or B and the neutral. And how the connections they do is, suppose, let us say on the R phase, 100 houses are connected. They will make sure that Y phase, 100 houses are connected, B phase, 100 houses are connected, so that they can have a kind of a balance among all these three phases. Okay, that we will see generation of three-phase power. We will see three-phase balance circuit. What is the meaning of this? Voltage and current relations in star and delta connections. Very important question from the exam perspective also. The voltage and current relations in a star and delta connections. We have three phase can be connected in three possible ways. Two possible ways. One is a star connection and one is the delta connection. We will see what are those star connection and delta connection. And once we have that kind of a connection, what are the different voltages? There is something called as a line voltage, something called as a phase voltage. We have to give a relation between the line and the phase voltage in case of a star and a delta connection. then measurement of three phase power using two wattmeters. I'm sure you are aware of what is a wattmeter. Wattmeter is the instrument which is used to measure the power. In case of a single phase power consumption, we connect one wattmeter, we will know what is the power consumption. In case of a three phase, one option is we connect the three wattmeters and we can measure the power. There is a better option, that is using two wattmeters. We will understand using two wattmeters how we can measure the three phase power. Okay, before we start with the three phase, first you have already understood the single phase, isn't it? Generation of the alternating voltage or the current. Okay, anybody has any questions? Or first we will see how we can generate the single phase alternating voltage or the current, which we have already seen earlier. Suppose let us say I have a one conductor, or you can say one coil, and it is placed in a magnetic field, and in that magnetic field, okay, please keep your phones muted. Kiran Karadi, please mute your. Thank you. All right. So we can place, we can have a one conductor or a coil placed in a, excuse me, placed in a magnetic field, and this conductor will be rotated in this magnetic field with the angular velocity of omega or linear velocity of v. Now, when we are rotating this coil or a conductor in a magnetic field, what happens is the flux linked with the conductor or the coil changes. And from Faraday's first law, we know that how EMF is generated in a conductor or a coil. Whenever the flux linked with a coil or a conductor changes, an EMF is induced. So based on that principle, EMF is generated. And if you connect the load across that, the current will also flow. That is also alternating. Now, at position number one, if you see here, the direction, this conductor is going to be rotated anticlockwise with a speed of angular speed of omega radians per second. And at position number one, at each position, what we are going to do is we are going to record how much EMF is generated in this particular coil or a conductor. So we start with the time zero here, time zero. At this particular position number one, the direction of motion is like this, okay? And the direction of the flux is like this. The angle between them is zero. At this position number one, the flux cut by the conductor is zero. Hence, the EMF induced is zero. So we can plot that one. Now, the conductor is rotated and it moves to the position number two. When it is rotating at position number two, the direction of motion is like this, and the direction of the magnetic flux is like this. The angle between them is 90 degree. That is when maximum flux is cut by the conductor. When the flux cut by the conductor is maximum, EMF induced is also maximum at position number two. So this position number two is nothing but, it is pi by two or the 1/4 of the cycle. So if you see here, this one revolution is representative of one cycle, and from position one to two, it is the quarter cycle. You can see maximum flux is generated at position number two. Then we continue to rotate that, okay? And when it comes to the position number three, the direction motion is exactly downwards, and the flux direction is also in the same way. Angle between them is zero. Therefore, the flux cut by this is zero, and EMF induced is zero in position number three. And if we plot that on the graph, we get the position number three here. Now we continue to rotate that one, and at position number four, the direction of motion is like this, and the direction of the flux is like that. Angle between them is 90 degree. So the flux cut by the conductor is maximum, and EMF generated is maximum. But if you see, the flux at position number two was maximum, but it was under the north pole. Now at the position number 4, flux cut is maximum, EMF induced is maximum, but it is in the opposite pole. So the polarity of the EMF will change. So we have a negative peak at position number 4. Now it comes back to the position number 1. Again, the flux cut is 0 at this position number, EMF is induced is 0. In all in between position, let us say for the flux is here at an angle theta. Suppose the angle between the direction of motion and the flux is theta. The EMF induced in that particular conductor is directly proportional to the sine of that particular angle. So here angle is 0, sine of 0 is 0, so EMF is 0. Sine in this position, sine of 90, sine of 90 is 1, so flux cut is maximum. So in between, okay, in between these positions, the from 1 to 2, the flux would be between, EMF generated would be between 0 to maximum, that is 0 to the peak value Vm. So, and it would be in the sinusoidal nature. When this conductor completes one rotation, the EMF induced in the conductor would be like this, which is a representative of a sinusoidal voltage. So that is how we can generate a single phase voltage, one phase voltage. I have one set of coil here. I have induced one set of voltage. Now just assume that I have three sets of coils. So right now I have only one coil. Just assume that instead of one set of coil, I have an armature such that on that armature, I have three sets of coil, and let us say the first coil we have at a zero position, second coil after some phase angle, and the third coil after another phase angle. Normally in three phase, what happens is the three coils, okay, first we know that if instead of having one coil, if we have three coils and we rotate all the three coils, in each coil, we get a EMF like this, right? So each of those three coils will be having a EMF, alternating voltage. Now, in case of a three phase, exactly the three phase of the three coils are taken, and those coils are placed at an 120 degree apart. Means, let us say the three phases are R, Y, and B. R would be in phase with the zero. It will start from the reference, and the Y, R, Y, next is the Y. The Y will start after 120 degree. So this is 90 degree, 120 degree is somewhere here. The Y coil is placed in such a way that, okay, on the armature, the Y coil is placed in such a way that the EMF starts inducing in that Y coil after 120 degree. So what happens when we start rotating in the R phase, we start getting the voltage. It reaches the maximum at 120 degree. It will have some value. That is when the Y phase starts generating. Y will start from zero and it will have the same frequency, because we are going to rotate the armature, all the three coils, with the same speed. Then after Y, there is another set of a coil, B coil, that is placed 240 degree from R, or 120 degree apart from the B phase. Now, after from zero reference, this is 280, and after that we have 240 degree. Now, R phase will start from zero. At 120 degree, Y phase will start. And once it becomes 240 degree, the B phase will also start. So I will be having three phases. One is R phase starting at zero, Y phase starting at 120 degree, and B phase starting at 240 degree. And how to generate that one? Exactly similar to this. Instead of having one coil, we will be having three sets of coils. And the three sets of the coils are placed on the armature such that the R phase would starts from the zeroth position, and Y phase is placed 120 degree behind, so that the EMF generated in the Y phase will be delayed by 120 degree. And B coil is placed at an angle 240 degree with respect to R phase, or 120 degree with respect to Y phase, and the EMF induced in that B phase would be delayed by 240 degree. So we will be having three parallel ways you can assume. One starts at 0, one starts at 120, and one starts at 240 degree. They are represented as R, Y, and B. Those are the three phases. I hope you understood. We will see that again. I repeated the single phase so that you can easily correlate with the three phase. Okay. Three phase circuits. Necessity. What is the necessity of the three phase circuit? During earlier days, most of the time our requirement was for the heating purpose. So heating was the primary purpose of using the single phase, and second one is the lighting, right? Lighting was the second most important factor. But as the industrialization started growing, there was a lot of machineries, lot of motors that were required, and that is how there was a thought of going into a three phase, because the single phase was not sufficient, or it doesn't had that much power to run large machines. So the three phase was the necessity of the invention of the three phase was felt at that time. And what is the advantage of having the three phase? The biggest advantage is the output of three phase machine is always greater than the single phase machine of a same size. So suppose we have two machines which are of same size. One is single phase and the second one is three phase. Now the three phase machine, even though it is same size as the single phase machine, it can have the output 1.5 times the single phase. And for the same size rating and voltage, three phase machine takes less space and less cost. Suppose if I create two machines, one with a single phase, same size, same rating, everything is same, the three phase will take lesser space, and it will be less costlier because of its size is less. So automatically the cost would be less. And for transmission and distribution, three phase system takes less copper or conducting materials than single phase supply. So I told you all the generation, transmission, distribution that happens as a three phase. When we are doing three phase system, for example, in case of a single phase system, I would require two wires. Okay, one is phase, one is neutral. But in case of a three phase, there are delta connection as well as a star connection. If I use the delta connection, I need only three wires, right? So you can imagine I'm getting three phase with just only three wires. Or if I use the star connection that is used on the distribution side, transmission side is always delta, right? So that we can save the copper, one wire will be saved. If we use star connection, we will be having the four wire. We will see how it is three wire and the four wire. That is how we are able to save one wire. That is how we can save the conducting material compared to single phase. It is possible to produce a rotating magnetic field by three phase supply. Hence, three phase motors are self-starting. This we will see little later when we deal with the motor, but now you understand using three phase, right? Using a three phase supply and using three phase coil, I can create a rotating magnetic field. Okay, it's an imaginary rotating magnetic field, and when magnetic field is rotating, you can just think of what is the advantage that will give us. If I have a rotating magnetic field, just keep a coil or a conductor in that, it will produce EMF, isn't it? So how that is used, and how to prove three phase supply will create a three rotating magnetic field, that proof is there. We are going to prove that it will create a rotating magnetic field. And three phase system gives a steady output. So one of the advantage of three phase system is it gives a very steady output. Because there are three phases, the output is very, very steady. Single phase supply can be obtained from three phase supply, but three phase supply cannot be obtained from the single phase. I told you all the single phase connections that we get are from the three phase. So easily we can get a single phase connection from a three phase, but vice versa is not possible. Using single phase, we cannot get a three phase supply. power factor of a single phase motor is poor than three phase motor for same rating. So power factor, we already understood what is a power factor. It is the cos of the angle between the voltage and the current. By having a good power factor, we can increase the active power. So that is the advantage. So if we use the three phase, normally the motor will have a better power factor, so it can give a better active power, useful power. Now we will come to the generation of the three phase power or the voltage. Now you have already understood how single phase power can be created using what? One set of a coil. Now only difference in this particular diagram compared to the earlier diagram what I showed, I have here three sets of coils. So R1, R2 is the one set of a coil. We call it as R phase. And you can see this is next one, Y1, Y2. So this is another set of coil. All these are mounted on the same armature. Okay. They are displaced by 120 degree. If you see here, the angle between the R phase and the Y phase, this phase, okay, this particular angle, it is 120 degree. So I have Y1, Y2, that is Y phase, which is mounted 120 degree apart from the R phase. Now, next one is I have one more set of coil B1, B2, which is called as a B phase or the blue phase, red, yellow, and blue. And if you see the B phase, it is placed at 240 degree from, if you see here, R1, this angle is 240 degree. Or if you compare with Y phase, the angle between Y and B is 120 degree. So you can just see like the angle between R and B is 120 degree, R and Y is 120 degree, Y and B is 120 degree. So all these coils are placed 120 degree apart. Now just assume this is a fixed on the armature winding and it is mounted on a shaft and you are going to rotate it. Let us assume we are going to rotate it anti-clockwise direction with a speed of W radians per second. So that is the speed we are going to rotate these three coils. Now you can observe, now R1 is in a position, first position, right? At this position, the angle between, this is the direction of motion and this is the direction of the magnetic flux, north to south. The angle between them is zero. So the flux created at this position in R phase is zero. Now this R will start rotating. Okay. So it will start rotating and it comes to the position 2 here. When it comes to the position 2 here, so direction of motion is like that and direction of the flux is like this. Angle between them is 90 degree. So the flux cut by the R phase is maximum. So EMF generated at this position in R phase is maximum. So if I plot, earlier it was zero, now it has reached to a maximum. And all in between position, the EMF generated is directly proportional to the sine theta. Now, this is 90 degree and it moves to further 120 degree, right? To further 30 degree, that is 120 degree. Now R1 is in this position. Now the R1 has moved 120 degree. Y1 will move to another 120 degree, right? Y1 will move to 120 degree. So Y1 will come in position number 1, where the flux cut is zero. So at 120 degree, the Y1 is at this position, the EMF induced is zero. As Y1 moves further 90 degree, okay, when Y1 moves further 90 degree, the flux induced in that would be maximum. That would be 120 plus 90 degree. That is when it will have the maximum flux value. Then in other R phase, it is continued to generate, right? R is rotating. Y1 started from this position. Again, from here, it will have a complete one cycle. R1 from this position will have a one more cycle. Now, when R1 moves to a position of 240 degree, like Now R1 is in the position of 240 degree, and this Y1 would be in this position 120 degree apart, and this B1 would be in this position. So B1 is 240 degree apart, right, with respect to R. When R moves 240 degree, the B1 will come to the position number 1. So where EMF induced is 0, so from that point the EMF will start generating in the this coil. So when the B1 comes to this position, that is 90 degree from position number 1, a maximum EMF would be generated in the B1 phase. So when would be that be happening? After 240 degree plus 90 degree. Why 240 degree plus 90 degree? So it will take B1 to come to this position 240 degree, and after it comes to 240 degree, another 90 degree plus 90 degree, this B phase will have the maximum value, and when it makes a complete rotation, it will have the one cycle of a EMF induced in that particular coil. So that is how when this three coil starts rotating, then we will have three phase voltage. So I will have R phase, Y phase and B phase. What is the difference between them? R phase, it starts from the zero reference. Y phase, it starts after 120 degree. B phase starts after 240 degree. Now, if I represent the EMF induced in these coils, then I would represent EMF, instantaneous value of the EMF that is induced in the R phase. ER is equal to EM sin omega t. Correct? Then all the coils, number of coils, type of a conductor, everything is same. All R coil, Y coil and B coil are exactly the same, except that they are placed 120 degree. Now, if I represent what is the EMF induced in the Y phase, EY is equal to sine omega t minus 120 degree, because EMF is going to get generated after a delay of 120 degree. Then on the similar line, EB is equal to EM sine omega t minus 240 degree. And EM, that is the peak value of the EMF induced in each phase, is exactly the same. Why it is same? Because the conductor, type of the conductor, length, the number of turns, exactly equal. If you remember from the earlier module, EM is directly proportional to BLV, or E is directly proportional to BLV. Here, B is not changing, the length of the conductor is not changing, velocity is not changing. So EM value will remains constant. So this is how the three phase EMF or the three phase power is generated. How we are going to represent with the phasor diagram? This is the R phase. Okay, so maybe if you want, you can represent R phase here, and behind that Y phase by 120 degree, and behind that 240 degree B phase. So anyways, you can represent. So this is R, Y and B, and you remember the phasor rotate in an anti-clockwise direction. You can see once R becomes a zero, okay, it will take for Y to generate 120 degree, and for B it will take 120 plus 120, 240 degree. The same explanation is here. Okay, now how we represent the three voltages that are generated in three different phases. ER is equal to EM sin omega t, EY is equal to EM sin omega t minus 120 degree, so there is a 120 degree delay. EB is equal to EM sin omega t minus 240 degree, so there is a delay of 240 degree. So these are the three phases, these are the three equations for the instantaneous voltages generated in R phase, Y phase and B phase. And if we draw the waveform, this is how it would look like. Okay, the first one, it starts from the reference, that is zero. ER is equal to EM sin omega t. That is how I am going to represent ER. And EY is going to start after 120 degree. So you can see this is 120 degree. After 120 degree, EY is going to start. So from there, it would be like this. And the time taken for one cycle is exactly the same for three phases. Why? The speed is same. All are mounted on the same armature, so everything will have the same frequency. There is no change in the frequency, and their peak values are exactly the same. Why their peak values are same? The type of the coil, number of turns, length of the coil, everything is, all the three are exactly the same. That is why all the three EM values are same. That is why we call it as a balanced supply. Then EY, EY is what? EM sine omega t minus 120 degree. So you can see a phase of 120 degree. Then we have the EB. EB is represented as EM sine omega t minus 240 degree. So from here, 0 to the beginning of the B phase, that is 240 degree, that is the A phase. From here, it will start. So that is how you can see all these three phases, they are separated by the 120 degree. Now to remember these three equations, this is the sequence we always follow, R, Y, and B. Whichever starts at 0, the reference is considered as R phase. Whichever starts after a phase of 120 degree is considered as Y phase, and whichever phase starts after a phase of 240 degree is considered as B phase. So ER, EY, EB. Okay, so when I talked about phase sequence, I keep on telling RYB, RYB, right? That is the phase sequence. So first I get is the R voltage, then Y voltage, and B voltage. What is the phase sequence means? The sequence in which they get a maximum value. So first R will take the maximum value, then Y will take the maximum value, then B will take the maximum value. That is called as the phase sequence. So what is the phase sequence? The sequence in which the voltages in three phase reach their maximum positive value is called as a phase sequence. Generally, the phase sequence is R, Y, and B. Why this phase sequence is so important? Suppose if you are connecting two different three-phase systems, then R should be connected to R, Y should be connected to Y, B should be connected to B. And even if you are connecting two generators, I told you normally in the generating station, we don't have just one generator. There will be multiple generators that will be running. That is also to take care of the load. When the load increases, they will add more generators. When load decreases, they remove some of the generator. When they are connecting the generators, okay, to the grid, they have to follow this sequence, phase sequence. They have to follow R, Y, B. What is a balanced supply? I told you, right, the three equations we wrote. EY, ER is equal to EM sine omega t. EY is equal to EM sine omega t minus 120 degree. EB is equal to EM sine omega t minus 240 degree. In all these three phases, the peak value, that is EM, is exactly the same. Means the voltage that is generated is exactly the same in all these coils. Why it is same? We have made sure that all the three coils are having a same material, same length of conductor, same number of turn, so that the EMF induced is exactly the same. If we have such a voltage, that voltage we call it as a balanced supply. So this is a balanced supply. In three-phase supply, if the voltage between any phase is same, then it is called as a balanced supply. This is another way to put it. If the voltage between any two phases is exactly the same with any other two phases, then we call it as a balanced supply. When I have a three-phase supply, so this is one of these coil is, this is R, this is Y, and this is B phase. Their one end are connected to each other. The other end is taken as the terminal. Okay, that's why you can see this is R phase, this is Y, and this is B. This is one type of connection, and this type of a connection is called as a star connection. This what you are seeing is nothing but a star connection. This point is nothing but a URL. And what is a this point is nothing but the neutral point. And what you are seeing is a balanced supply, where the voltage between any two terminals is exactly the same. That is called as a line voltage. For example, between terminal R and Y, ERY is exactly equal to ERB, which is between the voltage between R and B terminal, and we have voltage between Y and B terminal, EYB. If those are the three voltages, the balance supply, in case of a balance supply, ERY is equal to EYB is equal to EPR. So that is a balance supply. When you are generating the voltage, when we have all the same coil, it will generate the same voltage. So that is how we can have a balance supply. How to get the imbalance supply? Just have a more turns in one of the coils. Suppose R, the number of turns is double these two, then we have imbalance supply because the EMF that is induced in the R phase would be higher compared to this. So that is why we say this relations will not hold good. ERV would be higher. If we have all the same turns, same material on the three phase coils, then we will have ERY is equal to EYB is equal to EBR, which we call it as a balanced supply. And in practical, we look for only balanced supply. All the supply that we get to our household industry, everything is a balanced supply. And next one is a balanced load. What is a load in case of a AC? It can be a resistance, it can be inductance, it can be capacitance, or it can be combination of those RL, RC, RLC, or any series or parallel combination of those. That is the load. So since in case of a single phase supply, we had a single phase load. What is single phase load? Just having one resistor, having one inductor, or a capacitor, or a combination of RL or RC or RLC, one piece. That is a single phase load. Now, in case of a three phase load, I will be having a three resistors or three inductors or three capacitors. Either they are connected in series or they are connected in sorry. Either they are connected in star or they are connected in the delta fashion. A balanced load in three phase supply, if the load for all three phases, that is R, Y, and B, is same, then it is called as a balanced load. Both magnitude and the nature of the load has to be the same. Now you can see this is the balanced supply, that is a supply side, and it is supplying a three phase load. And in three phase load, you can see this is the impedance of this particular path. This is another impedance, and this is third impedance. All these three loads, they are connected in a star. Okay, and we call it as a balanced load when the impedance values are exactly same for all these three impedances. What it says, both magnitude. So if it is 20 ohm, this is also 20 ohm, this is also 20 ohm. That is magnitude. And nature of the load has to be same. Nature of the load means what? If I have R, I should have R, I should have R here. If I have RL circuit here, this should be RL, this should be RL, and their magnitude should be same. Suppose I have RL here, RC here, and RL here, but all are 20 ohm. We cannot say this is a balanced load because even though magnitude is same, okay, 20 ohm is same for all the phases, but the nature of this one is different. These two are RL circuits and this is a RC circuit. In that scenario, we do not call it as a balanced supply. Sorry, balanced load. For the load to be balanced, we need to have both the magnitude as well as the nature of the load should be exactly the same. This is the balance supply. ERY is equal to EYB is equal to EBR, and this is the balanced load where L1 is equal to L2 is equal to L3. L1 is a indicative of the load. L1, load 1, load 2, load 3. It might be having impedance Z1, Z2, Z3. So Z1 is equal to Z2 is equal to Z3. That is magnitude is equal. Also nature means if all are resistors. If all are RL circuits, all are RC circuits, we should not have a combination of RL, RC or different combination. So magnitude should be same as well as the nature of the circuit should be the same. Now first we will look into the relation for the star connected load. So maybe there are two options to connect the load. Either we can connect it as a star. This is one phase, that is R phase, Y phase and a B phase. You can see, just you can imagine there are three sets of coils. One is the R phase coil, Y phase coil and B phase coil. And R phase one of the end, okay, Y phase one of the end, B phase one of the end, they are connected together. And other ends of the three phases are open. Then we call this as a common node or the neutral point. And these are the three terminals. Okay. R is one terminal. Then B is another terminal. And this Y is one more terminal. So we have three terminals for this particular circuit. Now, how many nodes we have? This one node, this is second, this is third, and this is fourth. Either we can say this or this, both are same. Okay. Similarly, this point or this point, both are same. What are the different voltages we have? We can have a voltage across the VR, that is just the this phase. This is called as a phase voltage. V represented as a capital R, suffix capital R. This is a phase voltage because it is voltage for this phase. Similarly, I have phase voltage VB. So this should be capital V and B. That is the phase voltage between the B. And then I have one more phase here. The phase voltage across this is VY. And what is the current that flows? The current that is flowing is this is called as a line current. And current flowing in a phase is called as a phase current. And the voltage between any of these two terminals are called as a line voltages. So what is the line voltage? Line voltage is the line voltage between the any two terminals. So this is voltage between R and B. R and Y is VRY, R and B VBR, and Y and B VYB. These are the three line voltages, and these are VR, VY and VB. These are called as the phase voltages. We have to find the relation between this line voltage and the phase voltage in case of a star connected load, which we will see in the next session.